everyone, and good morning, and welcome to the Backyard Garden. Of course, I'm here live every Sunday morning at about 10:30 a.m. Central Standard Time. However, I want to remind everyone to be sure to say hi, jump in, ask questions, and take a chance to stop and subscribe my YouTube channel. If you'd like to catch the replays, past episodes, or if you're watching this recorded replay right now, please just subscribe. That helps me continue to do more of this great public gardening information. Now, last week's episode, there were some questions about timing of planting. So I said I'd come back and talk about that this week so that I can give a little bit more detailed information. And then the other thing is, in typical Texas fashion, we had another weather event. And so let's look around at my garden and talk through some of the things that I'm managing through weather events. Now, where you're located at, you might not have had the exact same type of weather event, and or you might not have had these exact same type of rain, and your yard or your location may act differently. But this gives you the opportunity to see what happens and what are some different opportunities and things that you can do when these types of things occur in the places that you do grow at. Because if you grow in Texas, you're gonna see things like this regularly. And if you grow in other parts, you're gonna see them from time to time. And I expect that as we're starting to see that definite climate shift, we're definitely gonna see things that are unexpected on a regular basis, no matter where we're growing at. And so it's a great opportunity, again, for us to talk about those types of things. So I wanna also remind you guys like I said, I do this every week. And so there's an opportunity for us to interact. So be sure to ask me questions. I will do my best to jump back on, and then we can talk more about things as we follow up with that. A couple of things I wanna, and I always mention this, I wanna make sure that when you're planting seeds and you're looking at seed packages and you're beginning to think about your purchases for your seed, for your gardens for the next season, because believe it or not, in about May, June, July, we start planning and ordering our seeds again because we're gonna begin planting in the ground again in the end of September or even in October. And so we're already moving in that direction again down here in deep South Texas. So as you're looking or purchasing seeds or looking at what are the last seeds you wanna plant here at the end of the season, right before we start to get our real summer heat, you wanna look at the backs of that and get an understanding for what's happening in terms of your soil temperature. Now there's certain things you can do that are pretty easy for getting your soil temperature, and that is you can just use the same meat thermometer that you use inside your house, and that gives you a better estimate of what's happening with your actual soil. Now right after a nice cooling weather event, we're gonna have cooler temperatures, but within a couple of days, that the soil will start to heat up again with all that moisture in it, because that's the thing, is all those microbes in the soil are just gonna start getting alive, 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 alive. And so in addition to the heat that's coming down and the moisture that's and the warmth that's being created, those little live bacteria and creatures help to create more warmth. And then the temperature of the soil rises very quickly. And so as we move through this time of year, the hardest part for planting seeds has everything to do with the soil temperature.
It's the air show.
It's already, that's what's happening.
The air show was this weekend. It largely got canceled yesterday because of the 8 inches of rain.
Oh.
But when you went to the farm yesterday, the Blue Angels were flying all afternoon.
Well,
so,
isn't that a lovely treat?
We'll get interrupted by a dog. We'll get interrupted by a weed eater. We'll get interrupted by chickens.
And then jets.
That was a first. You better hurry.
Okay.
They're coming back.
All right. So, germinating from harvest means you want to keep that range, look at the seed package, look at the temperatures, but as we get into those summer seeds, we're looking at the 80s, staying in the 80s. It sounds like we're having a war. Cover! Okay, something else I want to make sure to talk to people about, because I just
What should I do
question.
With all the mushrooms popping up?
Ignore them. Just ignore them. They're going to be just fine.
What?
When you're looking at the seed germination package, when they give you that date to harvest, you also need to understand that the date to harvest is going to go from the date that actually the seed germinated. So when you actually begin to see the seed sprouting and coming up. So those are things to remember. We're in that time period right now where we're backing off on most of our planting of seeds, okay? Unless you've got safe, cooler pot places to blow, not pot places, but places with pots to grow your plants. So things that I'm planting directly in the soil right now is okra, roselle, cowpeas, that's any kind of purple pea, purple hull peas, black-eyed peas, cream peas, any of that kind of stuff. And sunflowers, of course, zinnias, and you can also do your sweet potatoes if you still have some sweet potato slips for that. Things that I'm planting still from transplant that may or may not produce fruit before next fall are the tomatoes, peppers, eggplants. Now, your eggplants are likely to continue to produce fruit almost all the way through the summertime outside of the very, very, very hot temperature months. Your peppers will also produce here for a while.
Here comes the danger zone. It's way up there.
That one over there. Yeah. And then your tomatoes, as soon as they start to hit 85 and stay consistently above 85, they'll stop. Most of them will stop producing. Some of the little cherry tomatoes will still produce. But go ahead and keep putting in your transplants and protecting them. If you have them in pots, you want to make sure that you keep them watered because that's really important. They dry up a lot faster, but that's really a pretty safe place for your young eggplants, pepper plants, tomato plants. And then any of the flowers in pots and herbs in pots, same kind of thing. You may need to, as the summer heat really starts to set in, now that starts to come really in late July, August, September. When you run into that heat, that's when you're gonna wanna just do anything you can to protect them. But at this point, any transplants may still produce. We're just kinda still in that range of the 80, going from 85 to 95 and back and forth. And we may even get down in the 70s again. And then, you know, we may have a day where we go up to 97, just like we did last weekend. Some things you can experiment with. I can't guarantee you they'll work, but they may. And I'm certainly gonna continue messing with these seeds. And that is my beans, so any kind of green beans that I still have available to plant, any of my summer squash, I'm definitely gonna still play, especially, particularly with those seeds, when you're looking at date to harvest, when it's 30 days to 50 days, and also your basil seeds, 30 days to 50 days, those still are gonna be able to germinate really quickly and get up popping and having their flowers and all of that beautiful stuff. So those are all the same kind of things that you wanna keep planting. As I mentioned before, let me go through the list again just because of all of the noise distractions we've had today. Things that I'm planting in the ground, still will probably continue planting till the end of May, maybe even play with into June, is okra, roselle, cowpeas, sunflowers, zinnias, zinnias and sweet potatoes. And then transplants that I'm still planting in the ground, tomatoes, peppers, eggplants, flowers, herbs. If you've already got cantaloupe, watermelon, pumpkin, summer squash, any of those transplants, if you've already got those, go ahead and put those in the ground as well. And then if you want to keep experimenting, things that you can keep experimenting with are beans, summer squash, maybe even some of the short season cucumbers, like more of the bushing cucumbers, some of the short season cantaloupes and watermelons, some of those bushing, but look for those dates. And that's really important. And remember, the date is from the date that the seed actually germinated. So you still have maybe a week or two before, depending on how quickly those seeds germinated. Now, we're gonna see a lot of growth after what we had was a pretty massive rain event. It's not unusual in South Texas at all for us to get these summer thunderstorms. That's when we begin to know that we're really moving into our true summer, is when we start to see these major, like, almost like flash flooding thunderstorms. And we did see some of that here over the weekend. We got about 12 inches out in Taft at the farm. Do you have any idea how many inches we got here? Definitely over 5 inches. There was a lot here. And we're getting this great, fantastic show. I have to remember these things each year, right? It might have happened on a Saturday, but now it's happening on a Sunday. So, okay, so you're gonna see a lot of growth. You're gonna see a lot of germination. If you had any seeds in the ground, I had a lot of seeds in the ground, so I'm pretty happy about that. You're gonna see all of that type of growth happening, but you're also gonna see all of the pest growth happening and all of the pathogens. So this is when you'll probably begin to see any of the blight and powdery mildew and things like that that we hadn't really seen up until this point. this is when you're going to begin to see some of this. The great thing about the flood drought that we deal with down here is that if you got your garden set up in a way that they hold a little bit of water, particularly with a lot of mulch, and the way I build my beds, I do a swale around the garden so that I've got a hole filled with mulch where the water can settle in around my garden in addition to being sucked up into my garden, because I use so much carbon material and organic material inside my raised beds. These are the places that you're gonna be able to then hold that moisture. And so it's really good, the flood drought, because you flood the garden and then you don't water at all. So we shouldn't need to water now for a bit, for several weeks, and it could be several weeks that we don't need to water, depending on kind of what happens with our heat and our wind. Things that you have to pay attention to in terms of watering are, how fast does that heavy, heavy wind come through and dry everything out, especially when you're talking about the little pots or small pots. You keep an eye on those. But if you're seeing mushroom mold, even the slime mold, dog vomit mold we talked about a few weeks back, that's not harmful, but is there, then you know there's plenty of moisture in your garden. Yep.
In the construction business, after a big rain event that's going to keep us off of a site,
yep,
sun is great, but sun plus wind will dry out a job site faster than anything.
Yeah, absolutely. And it can actually get really hard and compacted.
Right.
And so those are some things to keep in
Crystal
mind.
Wants yes. to know if you can show everybody the Roselle.
I don't have Roselle big right now, but the baby of it looks very similar to okra. It's in the same family as okra, cotton, hibiscus, things that we grow really well down here. But it grows into a pretty nice sized bush, and then it puts on these little red carcasses that are good for using for jellies and jams and things like that, and then a really pretty flower that's an edible flower, and you can also eat the leaves, and it makes these gorgeous like star leaves that are really beautiful for you to use in your different beautiful salad making. And you know, I love to make those different kinds of beautiful salads. So those are things to keep in mind when I'm talking about the overgrowth and things like that. You're gonna need to, number one, pay attention to where onions are at. Like, how moist is it around the onion? Yesterday I had a place where the onions were standing in water, and so I went ahead and got any of them that were in the water. Feel around. YouTube record of this, I'm going to make sure to rename this episode the South Texas Angels Flyover episode. Blue Angel Flyover episode. But here you can see at the tops of the onions, kind of feel around on them. If they're like super, super smushy, go ahead and pull them out, because they're going to be getting too smushy and mold and rot down underneath there. But if they're still feeling pretty strong and stiff up here, just leave them alone. They'll be fine as long as they're not standing in water. Now, things you do need to be aware of is that, like, these things like this, these big flowers like this that I have, they can start drowning some things out. And if I have some stuff underneath there that I want to grow, like maybe even this onion you see, you can start to get too much mold. And one of the things you do need to pay attention to is, already before that heavy rain set in, a lot of the dill was putting powdery mildew in it. So it needs to come out, because that powdery mildew will transition to your squash. This is a really, really, really important time for squash, tomatoes, and things like that to be protected, because they're going to get too much moisture and they are going to get those pathogens in them. And then that's when you start having problems where you don't really get any squash after all of that. The rain events are what usually cause the challenges with squash, because squash, like a more dry area to grow in. So you can see in my mulched areas, I don't really have a lot of stain. I don't have any standing water. This was newly mulched this year, but you can see where this is an important time too, to make sure you're looking at your property. And then that way you have the ability to then like make some corrections in your property. And keep in mind, anywhere where you have a dip in the property, it's just gonna help you hold moisture there. So decide whether or not you wanna hold moisture in that spot. If it's not in an area where you're growing things, you might not want to hold moisture in that spot. But an inexpensive way, aside from putting some sort of sand or topsoil there, would be to put mulch down, of course. Yes.
You were going to point out this low area?
Yeah, I just was pointing out low areas in the yard.
And that's where we keep that chicken tractor. So the chickens are on that land a lot.
Yeah, and you can see in here now, because we've raised this up so much, you know, this would have been a flooded area, fully flooded area in the past. But we've managed to lift it up. And so now they just have nice little hidey holes and places to dig and lots of good bugga-buggas down there. It's like a little jungle for my little jungle birds out here. It gets pretty damp. This is part of the reason why I have said that this garden isn't a great garden for me to grow tomatoes and squash. I do have a few of those out here, but not too many because this garden, like I said, it just gets too wet back here. So out at the farm is where most of my squash and stuff like that, tomatoes and stuff like that are growing. But you can see I've got little tomatoes here that won't need to be watered for a while. Some other things you can plant right now, your seeds are your grains, any of your grains, if you wanted to plant those, they're good for right now as well. Keep an eye on your babies. If any of your babies are in standing water, get them out of the standing water, of course. This is where I have a lot of standing water. Not even sure I want to clomp around back here too much. But over here on this side, I took a really close look at my onions and pulled out onions that were in standing water back there. And then anything else, I just kind of left it because it still feels pretty strong. And this is going to dry up pretty quickly because the ground didn't have any water in it. So this is basically at a saturation point, and then it'll go out pretty soon. So you can see. And I'm going to have, like I said, it's the hatch. So here come all the insects. Here come all the mosquitoes. But hopefully, because of the freeze, this first major hatch won't be as bad as it could have been, all things considered. So here's to hoping, right? Alrighty, that was a beautiful, beautiful Sunday backyard garden with the extra special show that we got. And if you have any questions, about the planting of any of that stuff, and I'm pretty sure you can get okra and roselle seeds both right now at any of the local places where you can buy seeds from. trying to think. If I have any extra plants, I'll definitely let people know what plants I have. I just have been trying to keep caught up with all my plants and haven't gotten ahead enough to be able to have any of those yet. And be sure to check out the podcast because we actually have an episode this week. See you very soon. Bye.